Shabbat Shalom. When I was studying the Parsha this week, I thought of one of my teachers, Rabbi Dr. Aryeh Cohen. I imagine this is a person that many of you have heard of, or maybe some of you have heard of. He's definitely a rabbi that's very active in the community. And I studied with him a couple of different times, but the first time I took a class with him, it was a class in Talmud, and it was called Sugya Synthesis. Now, I don't know how much you know about Rabbi Dr. Aryeh Cohen as a Talmud scholar, but he does not mess around. He is quite the Talmud scholar. And when I took this class, Sugya Synthesis, it was less than a year after I started Daf Yomi, and it was the first time that I almost quit Daf Yomi. I was like, I'm totally overwhelmed. This is too much. I can't do this. I ended up, you know, completing the class and continuing with Daf Yomi, but there was a little moment of crisis in there. And I think that one of the reasons why studying with Rabbi Dr. Aryeh Cohen is so challenging is that not only is he very intelligent, he's very creative. And so he gave us all of these assignments, all these tasks that were really out of the box. And so one of these assignments was to read a particular tractate of Mishnah called Masechet Midot, which is probably something that none of you have ever heard of because it's not studied very much, because all it is measurements. So midot literally means measurements. It has a different meaning right now. There's a study of Musar where we think of midot as character traits, which is another meaning, but the literal translation is measurements, and all this whole tractate of Mishnah is all measurements of different parts of the Holy Temple. So we had to, I think there are 5 chapters in it, we had to read it and summarize it. I found this very challenging, and I'm thinking, why are we doing this? But so after we all prepare for the class, we arrive, and he has the video projector set up. And, you know, there's generally not a lot of video component to studying Talmud, so I'm thinking, what's about to happen right now? And he showed us this, like, 2005-era 3D graphical rendering of the Second Temple, based on all the information from Masechet Midot. So someone with skills in computer science and Talmud had combined their skills and made this essentially video of what it was like to be in the Second Temple based on all these measurements. So seeing this video, I don't know what it was, but it hit me that these taking stock of these details, keeping track of these details, is a labor of love. It can't be anything other than a labor of love. And for the rabbis of the Talmud, keeping track of these details and writing them down and saying 3 cubits and this was made of gold and this was made of bronze, that was their way of remembering the good old days. It's like when you drive past your childhood home and you're like, wow, that used to be my bedroom. Or when you're preparing for a wedding or a bar mitzvah, you get the photographer and the videographer because you want to make sure to document all that goes on in that special moment. And for the rabbis of the Talmud, Masechet Midot was like their wedding videographer, except it was for the Holy Temple, because it was something special to them that they never wanted to forget. And so this all occurred to me as I was studying our Parsha, Parshat Terumah, and trying to fathom what to talk about, what to teach. Because we're getting into the section of Torah that I fondly think of as the creative drashot section of the Torah. The narrative is few and far between. We're not in the book of Genesis anymore. And it's very common when people give Divrei Torah on these types of parshiot to seize on a word or phrase and get very, very creative about what that word or phrase could mean. And so I was thinking about doing that this week, and I instead thought, well, what if I took an interest in this parsha like the rabbis of the Talmud took an interest in the measurements of Masechet Midot to remember the Holy Temple. This time that we had the Tabernacle of Mishkan, this time of journeying from having been freed from slavery in Egypt and not yet reaching the Promised Land, this time, this experience, and the Tabernacle as our way, our place of connecting with God while we were on the road, this was so precious that our ancestors had to remember it by writing it down in the Torah. So we're going to look at some details. We're going to start at the very, very beginning of our parasha. And I'll just follow along here. If you'd like to follow along with your eyes as well as your ears, you're always welcome. So I love how the Eitz Chaim commentary has this outline. And so on page 485, it says the Tabernacle Part 1, Instructions. So we've got Part 1, and this is a very long Part 1. starts on chapter 25, ends in chapter 31. Our parasha is chapter 25, 26, and only part of chapter 27. So where the instructions for building the tabernacle are even longer than this parasha alone. But they begin here. So they begin with a list of materials. The idea is that as they're collecting materials to build the temple, everyone brings what they want to bring. Everyone brings what moves them. It wasn't like, well, if you live in this block, you have to bring this material. You live over here, you got to bring that material. Last names A through M, bring this. Last names P through Z, bring that. Everyone got to bring what moved them. But there was a materials list. People didn't bring whatever they wanted. People looked at the list of things that were needed and chose from that list. So that's the materials. Next, the parasha moves on to describing the ark, the aron. And so this is the most important part of the tabernacle because it contains the two tablets of stone that Moses wrote the Ten Commandments on when he received them from God on Mount Sinai. So this is an important piece of furniture, but really it's a particular type of storage furniture. So when you have like a cabinets in your house for extra Pesach storage or like those plastic boxes to put random stuff in, the Ark is a very, very holy and very, very important version of that. Now it next moves on to talk about the Kaporet, which is the Ark, it's the covering for the Ark. So the Ark, the instructions for it are to build it with an open top. And then the covering for it is a whole separate piece of furniture. Because the kaporet, the lid for the ark, is decorated with these cherubim. That there's two mythical creatures that, you know, are part bird and part human and part I don't even know what else, but the details are in here. And the thing about the cherubim is that God's instruction, God's voice, God's communication came from between the two cherubim. So if we pretend these microphones are cherubim, God's instruction came from right in the middle. And that's why the Kaporet was so important. Now we're moving on to the table and accessories. So we've got the materials, we've got the ark, we've got the covering for the ark, and now there's this thing called the table for the bread of display, the table for the lechem hapanim. Now, this is the first mention in our parasha of something edible. We're talking about bread, some type of bread, and I don't think it will surprise us to know that once we're talking about food, now we have a lot of different opinions about what this bread of display was. What exactly was it? How was it shaped? What did it look like? Did people eat it? Our Eitz Chaim quotes a source from the Talmud saying that they put the new pieces of bread on the table for the bread of display right before Shabbat. They sat there all week, and then when they were replaced the next week, the priests would eat that bread. I don't know if that sounds particularly tasty, but that's the job of a priest, I guess. But there are many different interpretations throughout the sources about what exactly this bread was and who ate it and when and what the story was. Our parasha itself just says the table had the bread of display on it. Next, we have a very important feature of any indoor space, as we know when we look at this room, which is lighting. So we have the menorah. It's a lampstand with six branches. So I know that for most people are very familiar with a Chanukiah. It's a particular type of lampstand with nine branches. We have eight for the days of Hanukkah, and then one extra for the Shamash. Now, the menorah is not a Chanukiah because the menorah only has six branches. So this is and the parsha specifies that it has to have six. Okay. Now, the next section is the roof. So we've had a lot of rain here in the Los Angeles area lately, which we don't usually have. So I think that anyone who spends time in an indoor space, businesses, synagogues, churches, homes, knows how important a roof is, especially now that we've been reminded by our wonderful weather. And so the roof of the tabernacle actually had four different layers. So the innermost layer was very decorative, made of linen. Then a layer on top of that was also decorative, a little bit less delicate, made of wool from goats, who knew? And then the third and fourth layers were not really decorative, they were functional, and they were made from leather. Next, the parasha goes and describes the wooden structure, the frame that holds the roof. So now we've got some furnishings, we've got the roof, we've got the frame for the roof to sit on, And those of us who have been camping, you know, you have the tent, right? And you have like the tent poles, which are kind of like you got to squish them in place to set up. And then you've got the covering like that. So that's kind of what we're thinking about. And now we're moving on to the inner curtain. So the inner curtain creates an enclosure for the ark. So that we have the ark with the kaporet, the cherubim, with the voice of God comes through the middle of the cherubim, and the inner curtain takes all of that and protects it. So it's not just hanging out there in the open, it's protected by this curtain, this inner curtain. Now, even after that, there's an outer curtain. So there's another layer of protection outside the ark, and this is where the table and the lampstand go. So the table with this bread, we don't really know what this bread is. The menorah, our light fixtures, very important part of any indoor design, that goes between the inner curtain and the outer curtain. And that's what the outer curtain is for. So now we've got the inner curtain, we've got the outer curtain. Now we've got like the outside space. So it wasn't just about the tent, it was about an area around the tent that we wanted to make sure was nice and special so that the tent would be very protected. So the outer altar and the accessories come up next in our parasha. The tent is in the courtyard, and the outer altar is in this courtyard. What the outer altar is for our burnt offerings. The Torah talks a lot about burnt offerings, different edible sacrifices that are made to God, which smell and sometimes taste delicious. Sometimes we eat them, sometimes we don't. And then the last thing that our parsha talks about, which is not the last part of these long, complicated instructions, is the enclosure, the Chatzer HaMishkan. So this is the enclosure or courtyard of the tabernacle, and it separates this area around the tabernacle from normal space so that people can't rush the tabernacle and think this is business as usual. No, something really special is going on. So that's the conclusion of our parasha. It's not the conclusion of all the instructions, but it's a big chunk of the beginning. We get a sense of what's going on. And what I think is so interesting is that even today, even in the physical space that we're in right now for prayer, we follow this kind of form. So we have the ark. We don't have two tablets of stone, but we have our Torah scrolls that are in a special storage container with special doors. Then we have our bima. This is a special place for davening, prayer, teaching, Torah. And generally when people are coming to the bima, they're in some sort of role of leading the prayer, leading the teaching. Because everyone in the sanctuary is, of course, engaged in the act of prayer, Torah study, and is participating in this particular type of Jewish spiritual experience. And then we have the outside enclosure, the rest of our campus. And I think it's wonderful that lately, we, as we all know, our security has been greatly upgraded to make our enclosure even more safe than it was before, even more sturdy than it was before. And it's really about protecting all of the campus so we can protect the sanctuary, so we can protect the ark. So even though these instructions seem a little bit far away, we're following these customs in our current space right here, which I think is amazing. So as we're starting to close our teaching, I want to direct us to page 1520 of the Eitz Chaim. Even if you've only been following along so far with your ears, I'll ask you to follow along with your eyes at this point, because in the very, very back of the Chumash, where it's like, who turns back there even? There are pictures. This is amazing. So there's like a little floor plan at the top of page 1520, which is trying to be as true as form to possible to the details of the parasha. And Yoel, when he was reading Torah so beautifully, mentioned that the amma, the cubit, was originally the distance between the elbow and the fingertips, but of course that varies from person to person. Did we ever standardize a cubit? Not sure, but it's drawn to scale. And then we have the artist renderings. And I think what's so beautiful about the artist renderings is that they're an interpretation. The floor plan, okay, there's not a lot of interpretation there necessarily, but as soon as you try to draw it, as soon as you try to bring it to life, it's the artist vision in addition to the details of the parasha that are kind of filling in the gaps. Now, if your eye has already wandered to page 1521, there are some objects that were described in our parasha, like the lampstand, like the ark and the cherubim, like the table for the bread of display, and then some objects, like the altar for incense, that we have to wait until next week's parasha to learn more about. So as we look forward to continuing to learn about our sacred space of connecting with God in the desert, in the coming parashiot, in the coming weeks, we can be inspired by how this architecture and design from the Torah still influences the way that we design our sacred spaces today. Shabbat Shalom.